going to do is we're going to have a time of review or refreshing to get us back up to speed. Hopefully it doesn't have to be too much for you. Hopefully these things have been on your mind, as they are very applicable as we go about our daily lives, as we encounter the sufferings of this present time that are common to man. The only difference they are for us is that we're able to respond to them in a godly fashion, the very same way in which God himself, Christ himself, and the Spirit leads us in. We're able to respond to those things in a godly fashion. And so I'm going to review this, and then we're going to hunker down, and we're going to look at this, the concept here of the first fruits of the Spirit. It's oftentimes a concept that's confused. I want you to see what it is in the context, and I also want you to see the fruit that this is in connection with other places that Paul brings this up. This information that we're learning here is vitally important. It is something that Paul will refer to over and over and over again in his epistles, and so I want to give you that what we're getting here, nothing in Paul's epistles, nothing in God's word will we ever learn it and then just kind of put it on the back burner. It always comes up. It's always a part of our life. It's always interwoven with the other doctrines that we're going to be learning and those kind of things. But some do stick out more than others. Some of the caliber of the other of certain information is greater than others. And we're looking at one of those. This issue of our hope, the issue of our inheritance, the glory, the purpose that God has set us apart for, is significant. It's a carrot that he always dangles in front of us to press toward. Not just the issue of having eternal life, not just the issue of having the promise of the redemption of our body, not just the issue of being with him for all eternity, but a specific, particular, peculiar glory is what he always holds out to us, so that we will be all the more constrained and motivated to walk after the Spirit, because there's profit in it. Eternal, everlasting profit. And when you look at profit, there's no greater profit than one that is everlasting. And so what we have before us in this information, as well as in Christ, and in the education that the Spirit brings us through, is grand, is great, and that's an understatement. So we're going to just, again, review this, where we're at in verse 16 through 25, and then we'll, like I said, that'll catch us up to speed here in verse 23, and then I want you to see the dynamic nature that this hope, this salvation that he's going to begin to talk about is, and in the different context he brings it up in the rest of his epistles. So let's get underway here. In the context in which we're in, we're here in Romans chapter 8, the pivotal point here in Romans, where he not only moves from being justified to our sanctified identity in Christ, that which he began to do in Romans 6, but in Romans 8 here, he begins to take that sanctified identity in Christ, being dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God, and he begins to give it energy, begins to give it motion, that this identity is not supposed to remain static, but it is dynamic, it's able to walk, it's able to function. And how that functional life is going to commence is we have to be given things of the Spirit. Our life in Christ is dependent upon the Word of God. It is dependent upon the things of the Spirit that he is going to lead us in. After we learn that we have those things of the Spirit, that the Spirit has things for us and he's going to lead us in, then becomes the responsibility on our end. It's one thing to have those things before us. It's one thing for him, the Spirit, to be willing to teach us. It's a whole other thing for us to actually walk after it, to learn it. And that's what we learned in the the first half of Romans 8. That is, to walk after the Spirit, we need to mind the things of the Spirit. And in order to mind something on a day-to-day basis, you first have to learn it. You first have to get it in your mind for it to be the life that it's designed to be, for you to recall it, to remember it, to mind it, to pray in connection with it, to live by it. And all that's implied in connection with minding the things of the Spirit. Once we mind the things of the Spirit, that then becomes the life that it's supposed to be, and it's those things of the Spirit, the Word of God, is able to effectually work in us and utilize this mortal body as instruments of righteousness, as he said there in Romans 6. We're able to actually take this mortal body that still has sin in it, but with the things of the Spirit becoming the dominant factor in our mind, it's able to utilize this mortal body to actually to say something that's godly, to do something that's godly, to go somewhere that's godly, and all the other things that the Spirit's going to lead us in. In connection with that, and as we've learned that we're the sons and daughters of God because we have been given the Spirit of adoption who's leading us in our Father's business, and we are to be crying, Abba Father, and have that implicit trust in Him, the very next thing, after we learn that we have been given the Spirit, and the Spirit has wisdom for us, it has some things that He's going to lead us in, the next thing that He's going to lead us in is our purpose. And it's a beautiful way of education, whether it's the Spirit here or whether it's in the natural world. One of the great ways in which you can educate someone is to teach them that, okay, I'm going to teach you some things, and here's why I'm teaching it to you. So that you can always, and that's where this information, like I said, we're going to talk about it in Paul's epistles, so that you can always now, when you're in a specific portion of the education, and there might be some misunderstanding in regards to the application of the information, that you can always tie that information to the purpose. That you can always take a portion of the instruction or the education and say, you need this in connection with where we're going, what this is for. And Paul's going to do that, and it's the first place he does it in the doctrinal order of his epistles, as he sets forth the purpose of our walk. What are we walking after? Yes, the Spirit, but where's the Spirit leading us to? Ever think about that? Where's the Spirit leading? Without answering that, you're left to a subjective definition of His leading. Well, I think He's leading me here, and I think He's leading me there, and you for there, and you for there, and you have this mystical understanding of the Spirit instead of the objective leading of the Spirit and the grand purpose of it all. A lot of times when you're dealing with the leading of the Spirit, it's just the issue of your life now, and that's not to say that's not wrong, but that's only part of it. Your life now is practice. It's the training ground for your life to come in the heavenly places. And that's usually what's often missed, is that what we're going through now is training, practice for the life that is to come. And so in that sense, it's always objective. And that's what he's dealing with here. We are to walk after the Spirit. He's provided us to walk after the Spirit. The Spirit has things that He's going to lead us in. We are to mind them, but what for? And that's where the creature comes into play. That's where our inheritance, that's where glory comes into play. And as He brings all those things into play now, and He begins to reveal those things and lay them out, He's going to lay them out in a specific context of suffering. And He's going to put him in the specific context of suffering, because if He can talk about your walk in the context of suffering, how much more easier is it to talk about your walk when there is no suffering? And so if you can be successful in the one, you can most definitely be successful in the other. And that's only one reason. That's not the only reason. But that's one reason why He's bringing it up here. And how He wants us to view suffering is to be able to understand the certain kinds of sufferings from His perspective. There's the sufferings of this present time, that which is common to man, that which we experience most likely on a day-to-day basis, whether it's an ailment, an illness, some kind of infirmity in your body, whether it's the loss of loved ones, whether it's your mechanical things breaking down as man tries to harness the elements of the world into technology and other modern advances and those kind of things, that which can be utilized for God's honor and glory, that which cannot. But as we rely more and more upon those things, there can be suffering in connection with that, whether it's loss of a job, whether whatever it may be, whether it's a storm that causes a tree to hit your car or fall on your house and your house is damaged or whatever it may be. when those things that are common to man, that you and your neighbor can experience them just as much as one another, those are the sufferings of this present time. And then you have the sufferings of Christ, those which come from you learning the things of the Spirit, them, you minding them and utilizing them to impact your conduct and behavior. And when that conduct and behavior is revealed and manifested to an individual who is not godly, who is not saved, and who is opposed to God, therefore suffering can come into play. That's the suffering of Christ. And then you have the suffering from your own stupidity. The reap what you sow concept. If you reap, if you sow of the flesh in regards to foolishness and a lack of wisdom in this life, you're gonna reap that. You're gonna reap the consequences of that. And that has nothing to do, in one sense, with God, besides the fact that He put that in creation that we experience. That has nothing to do with God. That has everything to do with you and whatever decisions you make. Now, the one can impact the other, and it can take on a different form of suffering in the sense of, let's say, you are learning the things of the Spirit in regards to money and finances and how to work. Well, you'd be a fool to not listen to the Apostle Paul, the leading ministry of the Holy Spirit, that comes along and says, if you don't labor with your own hands, you shall not eat. Not be slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. That's instruction from God Himself, the Spirit Himself, to tell you to go out there and work. If you want to eat, you work. To be a fool is to not do that, and guess what the consequences are going to be? You're going to suffer not eating, not because of God bringing something against you, but because of something that you're not doing. So they can overlap too in that sense. So anyways, that's the way in which the Spirit's leading us to think about sufferings. And the first category is the sufferings of this present time. And how we differ from someone else in responding to them is by how we respond to them. We respond to them in a godly manner, the very same way that Christ Himself responds to them. And how He responds to them is by thinking upon something greater than what's going on in the mind. And that's wrapped up in verse 18 of Romans chapter 8. Look what he says there. He says, "For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us." The Lord Jesus Christ, sitting at the right hand of the Father, is still suffering, because again, we know already from verse 17 that we are to suffer with Him. Therefore, He's suffering. Not redemption sufferings, but He's suffering. And how He responds that suffering, He's at the right hand of God, and we think that just because He's at the right hand of God, that He is glorified to the fullest of the capacity that God wants to glorify Him. He's not yet. He waits. In fact, He waits to share that glory with you and I. And He waits. And how He responds to the suffering is to think about the glory that is to come and letting that persuade Him, letting that constrain Him, letting that keep His mind. Allowing that to be what He minds when the suffering, when he experiences the sufferings in His mind, and he starts to recognize those adverse effects of the suffering. He thinks about the glory. He is glory-minded when he's in suffering. And if we want to suffer with Him, not only do we suffer the things that He suffers, but we suffer them the way He suffers them, by being glory-minded. And when we're glory-minded, that paves the way for us to be glorified together with Him. Because it is essentially... let me say it this way, it is one of the very first things that we get to mind with Him. Not that He's got a whole bunch of things that He minds, but in regards to the sense and sequence of our godly edification, as we've been going through Romans here, one of the very first things that we get to mind with Him is to mind the glory when we suffer. That is what qualifies us suffering with him. We mind the things that he minds when he's going through things that we go through, or vice versa. And the way in which we're going to be glorified together with him is that we not only have the mind of Christ in regards to it being on the pages of God's word, but we become the living epistle of Christ. We live it out. It actually becomes our mind. We are actually conformed to it, conformed to his image. And once that then is in us and it becomes us, or we become it, that is what's qualifying us to be glorified together with him. And Paul, to lay forth meat or flesh upon the bone of this glory, he begins to describe this glory. And that's where he brings up the creature. And the creature, as we've gone back to Romans chapter 1, when Paul's going back in history and describing the Gentiles when they worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator. And we saw that in passages like in Deuteronomy 4, when Israel was coming out of Egypt and they're going through these lands, these Gentile lands, and as they're going to go into the land that God promised Abraham, or a fraction of it, as they go in there, there's Gentiles in there who came from that historical time that Paul's referring to in Romans 1, that Babylonian Babel worship and that idolatry that stemmed from that time. And as they were scattered, that idolatry now is all over in the world, and in the land, especially in the land that they're going to, of the hottest place of idolatry that you could have in the world when Israel comes out of Egypt is in the land that they're going into. And when in Deuteronomy 4, when Moses comes along and speaks on God's behalf to them that they are not to participate in that idolatry, he says that you make no similitude of man to birds, four-footed beasts, creeping things, of fish in the sea, nor look up into the host of heaven and worship and serve them. And you follow that pattern of Romans 1, you have man, birds, four-footed beasts, creeping things, then you have the creature. And so what the Old Testament in Deuteronomy 4 identifies the host of heaven, Paul's calling the creature in Romans 1. And that's where our purpose comes into play. We want to be glory-minded in the suffering. How we're going to think about our glory, the glory is attached to the creature. And what we're going to do with it and what God has us, what he's planned for us to be involved in connection with it. And that's where we pick up verse 19. He says, "For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God." It waits for the manifestation of the sons of God. And the manifestation of the sons of God is our complete manifestation. There's a couple phases to that, as we will eventually learn in Paul's epistles, and you might already have a knowledge of. The first phase is the redemption of your body. That's what he's going to bring up there in verse 23. The redemption of your body. And all that has to play in connection with the sufferings of this present time and is part of the glory, because you experience pain in your body now, in your mortal body now. Well, you will have a redeemed body then where you will not experience pain. But that's only part of the manifestation of the sons of God. Because once we receive a redeemed body before we go to the judgment seat of Christ, and once we go to the judgment seat of Christ in our new bodies, we will come out of it as we give an account of the things that are in us, because we're going to shed off this mortal body and this corruptible body, and we will put on immortality and incorruption at the judgment seat of Christ, and all that we can take from then to there is what we have in us. And we're going to give an account of what we have done in us. What is in us. And out of that judgment seat of Christ, we will be manifest to the measure of the sons of God that we are, based upon what we've done now. And Paul represents that in connection in many different places, in connection with the reward, in connection with the glory, the measure of glory that our new glorious bodies will manifest He says over in 1 Corinthians 15, when he talks about the resurrection from the dead, he says, not all flesh is the same. There's one flesh of animals and fish and those kind of things. And then he comes along and says, and then there's bodies terrestrial and celestial. And he says, and the glory of those bodies differeth from another. There's one glory of the moon, and there's one glory of the stars, and there's one glory of the sun, and one glory of the stars, and one glory of the star differeth from another star in glory. And he wants you to think about your resurrected body and the glory of it in connection with the celestial bodies up there. The sun, moon, and the stars, and the brightness of their glory. And when he gets to the end of that chapter, he says, therefore, we should always be abounding in the work of the Lord, for you know that your labor is not in what? Vain in the Lord. And that glory, not the resurrection of our bodies, that we have because of our position in Christ, but the labor, the glory, and the measure of it is attached to the labor. And we labor because we know it's not in vain. And what it's going to abound to and amount to is it's going to work for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And that's what he's beginning to introduce here. And that's the manifestation of the sons of God. And the creature is waiting for all of it. They can't wait for every believer to receive a new, redeemed, glorified body. And they can't wait for us to come out of that judgment seat, from that judgment seat of Christ, and to be able then to actually participate in the life of the creature, as we will function as the new creature, the church, the body of Christ. And they wait for that, and they wait for that, and they earnestly expect it because of verse 20. For the creature is made subject to vanity. What they experience now is vanity that's useless up there. It's not that they're not doing anything, but it's useless. It can never get the job done. It's like that hamster, if you ever, that just goes on the wheel and it's just the same spot. The whole time, just on the treadmill, you're just running in the same spot. It's one sense useless. You're not going anywhere. You're doing some things, but you're not going anywhere. And the creature can never, because they've been subject to vanity, can never fulfill and accomplish God's intent and role and function of the creature. They cannot. But God did not subject the creature and just leave it there. He says at the end of verse 20, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. And we dealt with the willingly concept there. The willingly concept has to be attached to one of God's creatures. Not the creature, but the creatures. And who are the creatures up there? In the creature, in the heavenly places, the angelic realm. And the angelic realm is divided, because we saw in Isaiah 14, Ezekiel 28, into the devil and his angels. As he fell, iniquity was found in him. And then he trafficked that iniquity in the sanctuaries up there in heavenly places. And then he came and he saw God created man in his image and after his likeness, different than how he created Lucifer, who sealeth up the sum, the greatest of his created beings at that time. He creates man, a little lower than the angels, but to be crowned with honor and glory, way better than the angels. And he goes to move and to influence that man before God can get done what he wants to get accomplished with man. And then sin enters the world and death by sin. And so you have the devil and his angels, but then you have the holy angels who did not go after the iniquity of Lucifer when he fell. Nevertheless, their whole dominion was subject to vanity. And even though they are still holy angels, they are subject to that vanity. They, therefore, will never experience the designed life and purpose of the creature under the vanity in which he subjected it to. That's why they can't wait for us to get there. Because they will finally experience its designed purpose when we're up there. So they wait. They wait for you and I. And they wait until God gets done what he wants to get done with you and I. See the importance of this? See how they can't wait for this, and Christ is waiting for this. But you got to ask the question, why are we waiting? We're waiting because we have this walk. There's some things that he wants to get accomplished with us in connection with his purpose with man in the first place. Is he wants to have a relationship. I know it sounds cliche, but not just any relationship. Not just a relationship so that you can do good. A relationship that does good in the context of qualifying you to reign in the heavenly places. There's nothing else like that. And they're waiting now to get that done. You ever hear these churches, and at Northwestern I was there, it was always this. It was, we got to fulfill the Great Commission before Christ returns. Let's go out there and evangelize the world. Then Christ will come. And they would even mark off the territories and the third world countries and the boonies in which they haven't gone before, and they'd go there in hopes that once they evangelize that part of the world, Christ will come. That's a doctrinal error of how the return of Christ. They can't control that in the first place. They don't rightly divide. But if they did, they have a misunderstanding of that. Because they misunderstand what God's doing today. It's not that God doesn't want you to go share the gospel and be an ambassador of Christ. I'm not saying that. But his purpose, as we're learning right here, is to deliver the creature. And that creature has principalities, it has powers, it has mights, and it has dominions. That God is not just going to fill with a foolish son and daughter. He's going to fill that with those who love him, who want to know him, who want to gain his wisdom, and rule with the same exact qualities that he has. His wisdom, his justice, his judgment, his equity, his discretion. His knowledge. And so he gives his spirit for us to be able to walk after him and be conformed into the image to be able to be placed there. He hasn't returned. Because he doesn't have, it's not that he doesn't have enough saints. Who knows? It's not about the issue of how many believers he's going to have. He's got some positions of authority that he's going to take the devils and his angels out of and replace with. And he's not just going to replace them with anyone. That's why he has a judgment seat of Christ. All of our sins forgiven. You ever, why is he going to have a judgment seat for believers? What's the purpose? It's because he wants to put those that are fit in positions of authority, so he waits. And he'll wait as long as he has to until his own, his believers, those that believe in him, wake up and see the necessity and the life and the glory that is attached to his words. So if you want to participate in the rushing of Christ returning, if there is anything that you could do, one, yes, go share the gospel with someone else, but not just share the gospel with them, get them edified. Mature them in the doctrine, which means that you first need to be matured. That's what we're doing here at Twin Cities Grace Fellowship. We're going through God's education for us, for his intended purpose, for us to be the new creature, not just by identity, but to be qualified to rule and reign with him. That's why he waits. And that's what we're doing here. And that's what our life should consist of every single day, is learning these things of the Spirit. Church is just a sounding board. It's just the start of what you should be doing on a daily basis, getting in the Word of God, learning these things of the Spirit, reading it and having it written upon your heart, and then be involved in prayer to see where you can apply these things that you're learning. That takes place more than just when we meet. and therefore how sweet the fellowship when we do meet. That's again what he's setting forth. And he took that creature who he subject to vanity, but also he reasoned in light of the evil and the error and the turmoil that the fall created in the heavenly places when Lucifer, when that iniquity was found in him, he reasoned. That's what reason is. Reasoning is in light of error and evil. You reason. He's subject to vanity, but he's subjected also in what? Hope. And therefore, the creature has a hope. He has a hope. That's, we need to know that because we're eventually going to get to Ephesians where he says that you might know what is the hope of his calling. His hope. It's his hope. His hope with the creature. The creature has a hope. They earnestly expect it. And it's all in connection. We get to have a part in it all. And therefore, it's also ought to be our hope. And therefore, this hope becomes a fruit to us. It's able to begin to produce some things in our minds, in our hearts, and in our lives. Before we get to that, verse 21 and 22. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption. That's also what's going up in there. It's in that bondage now. But it's going to be delivered. The danger and the imminent danger and the vanity that it's in, it's going to be changed. It's going to be delivered from that bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the glorious liberty that the child that's going to proceed from the children of God and what God's doing with us. And every believer. It just becomes to what measure will you play in that glory? And we'll see that as we go further on in Paul's epistles. But every child of God, every believer, every heir of God and joint heir of Christ will participate in the liberty that's going to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption. He says, for we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. We can understand that the pain that the creature is in by understanding also what creation and the pain that it's in. And going back and learning about the fall and the bondage of corruption that the earth in which we live is in. Well, the creatures in that same bondage of corruption, the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain. It's all in pain together until now. And the issue becomes that we're going to groan too. It's not that we haven't groaned, but now we're going to groan differently. Look what he says in verse 23. It says, and not only they, the whole creation, the creature and the earth, not only they, but ourselves also, which have the what? First fruits of the Spirit. So this groaning is not the groaning we had before we had the first fruits of the Spirit. This is a different kind of groaning now. This isn't mumbling and moaning and groaning in the sense that we think about in connection with the world. This is groaning in hope. This is knowing the staying condition that we're in our bodies, in creation. But knowing that staying condition, our bodies in creation, in light of the hope that is before us. It is a groaning that proceeds from possessing the first fruits of the Spirit. And he's going to talk about that. He's going to say, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. Now, what we need to handle is the first fruits of the Spirit. The first fruits of the Spirit, what are first fruits? Let me ask you that question. What are first fruits of anything? Or the first fruit, however you want to look at it.
Gifts.
What's that?
Gifts.
Gifts? Okay.
The initial results, the visible results of.
Initial results.
Could be good or bad.
Good or bad, okay. Think about it in agriculture, right? Who's ever early harvest? What?
What's produced? Reproduction.
Yeah. It's the fruit of the harvest, but it's the what of the harvest? The first of the harvest. Maybe it comes early, You know, as a farmer who, or even if you've had a garden, you know what tomato plant most likely, as it begins to put those little bulbs of tomatoes on there, which ones are going to be your first tomatoes that you're going to be able to pick off. When in the Old Testament, when an animal had its calf or whatever it might be, it was the firstborn. It was the first fruit. It's the first of what can be produced. It's the first of the produce. You have that word first, advance before or further than any other progression, it preceding all others. And as I stressed to you earlier, not only this morning, but in past lessons, is that the Spirit's education really gets underway here in verse 16. It's not that the Spirit hasn't taught us anything before, but all of it has been basically things that took place the moment that we believed, and we're just now catching up to that understanding of how God knows us, how He perceives us. Now, at this point, it's the issue of building upon that, and we talked about that in verse 16. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. That fundamental truth that we already knew, that we were justified, and therefore we were a part of, we were his children, and now he wants us to lead us into our inheritance. And now he's just exploded that idea of our inheritance, attached it to the creature, that which we didn't really think about before we got into this passage. It's the Spirit really begins to teach us here. It's the very first thing he begins to teach us. It's the first fruit of the Spirit. The first fruits, by definition, is the fruit or produced first matured and collected in any season. The first profits of anything. The first or earliest effect of anything. Now think about that in the context in which we're in. This is the first thing that we've really got under our belt when it comes to the Spirit. It's the first fruit of the Spirit. And when he says here, and not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit. The first fruits, and we'll talk about that here in a little bit, but we which have the first fruits of the Spirit. There's two ways in which you can look at this. And I think both are sufficient. One, we possess them just as much as the moment we believe, just as much as we possess our new identity in Christ, dead indeed in the sin, alive unto God, as we did the moment we believed. And then we learn about it later. Or you now possess it by learning it. Either way, what do you have to do? If you possess it the moment you believe, or whether you possess it based upon your learning, what do you have to do with both of them? You have to learn it, right? You got to learn it. You got to. We're going to walk by it and walk by faith with it and all those kind of things. But we first have to learn. Whether you possess it the moment you believe, and then learn about it later, or whether you learn about it and then you possess it, you still, in both scenarios, you have to learn it. That's what our walk is all about, learning the things of the Spirit. I would suggest, and I'm going to go into some other passages to show you that, is that you possess it once you learn it, this part right here. Really possess it. Because we're not just talking about our redeemed bodies. You can learn that doctrinally all you want. Go to conferences, learn that you're going to receive a new body. But there is something, that fruit of that doctrine, that's supposed to do something in you. Groan in sufferings as you wait for that hope. And oftentimes the connection is not made. And so in this context, they're married together. He never wants you to think about the creature, your glory, your inheritance, your new body, manifested as a son of God, first fruits of the Spirit. He never wants you to think about those things again without thinking about them to help you in sufferings. I should have said that a little differently. Because you can think about those things when you're not in sufferings, but he wants you to have those things in sufferings as well. That's the context that he has this in. And therefore, and as we're going to look at, is when we really begin to learn this, walk after the Spirit as he's leading us and teaching us, that we now possess it. And maybe depending on how you want to possess it, not just have it by way of being in Christ, but it now, as we learned in Romans 8, in the issue of the Spirit dwelling in us, not by way of justification, but by way of minding his things, he's now dwelling in us, is the issue here that when we have the first fruits of the Spirit, is it dwelling in us? We have it. Not as a foreign doctrinal thing that we say, yeah, I believe, but it's in us. It's dwelling in us. And when we have the first fruits of the Spirit, by way of learning it and possessing it and dwelling in us, and it's going to be something that we reckon in verse 18, we are going to groan within ourselves. Now, in connection with what the first fruits of the Spirit is oftentimes you read this, I remember reading this for such a long time, and what in the world are the first fruits of the Spirit? The first fruits of the Spirit are the exact things that we've been learning. That's just what he's calling them now. And if you follow the flow and the sense of sequence of the information, walking after the Spirit, and then leading us, and then the Spirit beareth witness with our spirit that we're children, and now he begins to teach us these things. The very first thing that he's teaching us is in connection with our inheritance and our hope, but how those things also are supposed to produce fruit when we go through sufferings. The very same mind that Christ has, the very same mind that Paul has, that we can reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed to us. All these things need to be working. The Spirit has to have them. The Spirit has to educate you in them. You have to go through them. And once now you possess them, you got to reckon it. You got to possess it. You got to. It's got to become you. And when it takes place, you have the first fruits of the Spirit, and that's going to produce something in your life, a groaning. Hopefully, that's what this information is starting to do in you. In the way in which it's been taught, that you groan, and hopefully now more. And I'm not saying you didn't have this before, but if you didn't, hopefully now more than just you're grown for heaven. But rather, you groan to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption. There's a little bit more to it than just that. All those things, I don't mean to say that none of those things are true. All those things are a part of it. But this part of the creature has got to be a part of it now. You groan because that's what the first fruits of the Spirit are. You groan to deliver the creature from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. You're going to bring that deliverance because you first have to have a new body. And in that new body, you're going to be able to do that. And then you're going to be manifest and you're going to be able to bring, you're going to be able to function as the new creature. It's the whole package of it. That's the first fruits of the Spirit. And you now have them. You now have them, because we went through them. You now possess those first fruits of the Spirit. And the very first thing that's going to lead you to groan within yourself is the very first part of it all, to wait for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of your body. That gets the ball rolling. And we'll learn more about that as we go on. Now, with that being said, and just generally put, and we're going to see more of its fruit specifically in verse 24 and 25, because that's what he's getting at now. Once you have the first fruits of the Spirit and you groan within yourself, waiting for the adoption to with the redemption of your body, while you wait and while you groan, as you have the first fruits of the Spirit, it's designed to do something. It's designed to save you when you go through sufferings. Not save you from them, save you in them. And that's why he's going to talk about, as he further explains and amplifies in verse 24 and 25, really the application of everything that we've been learning in verse 16 through 23. He says, "For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. And he's going to start to qualify all this a little bit more. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. And so as we go through the sufferings of this present time, and we begin to suffer with him, we're going to begin to reckon in mind the glory just like he does. And that glory, how we think about that glory is in connection with the first fruits of the Spirit. Think about the creature. Thinking about the deliverance we're going to bring in. Thinking about the manifestation of the sons of God that's going to be part of all that. Think about the pain that's going to go away when we get a redeemed body and our new body and how we need that to function up there. And as we begin to reckon that, and that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us, as we begin to do that, in the sufferings, we're going to begin to be able to experience a salvation in the sufferings. One that doesn't put the suffering and the hardship on a pedestal, but puts the glory on the pedestal. One that esteems higher something that you don't see greater than what you're experiencing. And a knowledge that our deliverance is only going to come in this passage in connection with the redemption of our body. That's when we'll have that deliverance. Now, if we die, we'll be in the present. We'll be present with the Lord. We learn that later, but that's what he's attaching it to. And he's attaching it because the body's in play. When your body is going to be delivered is when you get a new body. And that's not right away upon death, but we'll learn that later. And as we do that, and as we experience this salvation in the sufferings, because we're reckoning our hope that we can't see greater than what we do and what we feel, that's going to produce another fruit. Patience. And patience is again one of those things that Paul is going to bring up over and over and over again. And so with the time I have remaining, what I want to do is I want to show you this passage that we've been going through and the groundwork that it sets for things that we're going to learn later on in Paul's epistles in connection with it. You have the issue of our hope. This is later going to be talked about in Paul's epistles as the fruit, some of the fruit of the Spirit. There's a difference, but there's some of those things involved in the fruit of the Spirit. Paul's going to talk about it later on as armor. He's going to talk about it as the earnest of the Spirit. And there's even one other one that he actually calls, and I think that we've got it wrong for a while, he's going to call it the gospel of your salvation in Ephesians 1. And when he says it there in Ephesians 1, he's not talking about your salvation from the debt and penalty of your sin. He's talking about it to a believer who has already believed, and they hear what their foundational justification has afforded them, and there's more good news for a believer. There's a part of that gospel is the gospel of their salvation. The salvation, not from only the dead penalty or sins, but a salvation in connection with their hope and their glorified bodies. And so let's begin to look at some of these. Come with me, if you will, to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Second Corinthians chapter 1. Look what he says here. Let's pick it up in verse 19. He says, "For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus and Timotheus, was not yea and nay, but in him was yea. For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us." Notice how he brings up the issue of the glory of God and the promises. Those promises are unto the glory of God, and Paul is involved in ministering them. Verse 21, "Now he which establisheth us with you in Christ and hath anointed us is God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts." Notice there's two things there. There's the issue of verse 22, "who hath sealed us, comma, and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts." My understanding in verse 22, those two things are spelled out for us. One, the sealing of the Holy Spirit in Romans chapter 5, and the earnest of the Spirit is in Romans chapter 8. Now again, whether they take place the moment that we believe, either way, the moment that we believe and you possess them, in one sense, does you no good unless you learn them. So in either scenario, you got to learn them to really effectually work in you. You can ask many believers out there who do not understand that they're sealed by the Spirit, and they can be sealed all they want, but it doesn't help them in regards to their life and the comfort and the assurance that that sealing is supposed to bring. Now, for us who understand that they're sealed, it can bring us comfort in regards to if they were to die and we knew that they believed that they were sealed, brings us comfort, but maybe not them. So the issue becomes learning it. And how we learn that is through the doctrine. And where we learn that, the sealing is in Romans 5, and the earnest is in Romans 8. Now I want you to see those. Now we didn't learn them this way, but now that's what Paul's calling those things later on. Look at Romans chapter 5. And if you remember, when we went through this information, it will make more sense. And if you don't remember, that's why we're going through it. Look at Romans 5, look at verse 1. He says, "Therefore being what?" Past tense, right? We are being just, therefore being justified. We are justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. But then look what he does. It's actually a similar pattern when he first brings up to us the Holy Ghost here in Romans 5 and his shedding abroad the love of God in ministry. He brings it up in the context of tribulations. And tribulations that attack the understanding that we're justified by faith and faith alone, to get us to not think we're one of his and that we could lose our salvation or we're not saved in the first place or something like that. He brings up the Holy Ghost in that context. In Romans chapter 8, the Spirit in connection with the earnest expectation of the creature, the first fruits of the Spirit in the context of sufferings. And there you have that concept again. If you can understand that, if you can understand the sealing ministry of the Spirit in the context of the tribulations, well, when the tribulations aren't there, you're going to think you're sealed. And if you can understand the first fruits of the Spirit and the hope and all those things in the context of sufferings and what they can do in the sufferings, well, when the sufferings aren't there, how much more greater can you view your hope? But look what he says here in verse 3. He says, "And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience what?
Hope.
And hope maketh not ashamed, because the hope here was given in the context of our justification, our standing. And the tribulations are tribulations against that standing and our knowledge of it. And what the Holy Ghost does, look, he says, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is what?
Given
unto us. So the Holy Ghost is given unto us, and he does some things in our hearts in connection with our justification. And what he does is he sheds abroad the love of God in our heart. The very love that saved us, he's going to shed abroad, and it's going to take a different dimension to it. And if you remember through this passage, we went through this passage, and look what he does here. Verse 7. Just jump down to verse 7. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commended his love toward us in that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. And through those two verses, he's shedding abroad the love of God in our hearts to give us the knowledge of our sealing. If a man dies for a righteous man, he only dies for the righteous man because he's what? He views him as righteous. What does that tell you about that man's love? How deep is it? Not very deep. I die for you because you're righteous. Someone even, peradventure, someone even dare to die for a good man. I love that man because he's good. The depth of that love, the riches of that love is not very rich. It's pretty superficial. And usually why a man would die for a righteous man is one of pride as well as because his name's now going to be attached to that righteous man whom he views as righteous. Anyways, but then he says in verse 8, but God commended his love toward us in that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. And here's what that's supposed to teach you, is that if he loved you and he commended his love to you while you're a sinner, now that you're justified, how much more does he love you? You're sealed. You're sealed. And it's the Holy Ghost's love, shedding abroad love ministry in the context of tribulations against the knowledge of you being saved, that we get the knowledge that we're sealed. In Romans chapter 8, it's the issue of, what's the exact way he says it over there? In 2 Corinthians 1, he says, and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. Both are in our hearts. The sealing is in our hearts. The earnest of the Spirit is in our hearts. But when you get to Romans chapter 8, now you learn about the earnest expectation of the creature. The earnest of the Spirit that eventually is going to call the first fruits of the Spirit. He only calls it the first fruits once. Every time after that, he calls it the earnest of the Spirit. Because an earnest is the first money in that transaction. And it's the first fruit of your of that ownership, as it were. But every time after that, in Romans 8, he calls it the earnest of the Spirit. But when he talks about the earnest of the Spirit given in our hearts, and we should know that's where it's being done, in connection with things that he said prior to this. When he says the earnest of the Spirit, he's referring back to our first time going through it. And the first fruit of the Spirit and that hope. And it's been given to us. So here Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. By the way, 2 Corinthians is essentially all about the sufferings of Christ. He brings these things up. The sealing and the earnest of the Spirit given in our hearts. So again, it's not going to be the last time that Paul brings it up. Look at another one with me. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Look at how he brings it up now in this context. Over in chapter 1, it's in connection with the promises of God and the glory unto the glory of God. But here in chapter 5 now, it's going to be in connection with a new body. Look at verse 1, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house, which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. A believer is never looking for his life to end. He's never just looking to get out of his body and that it. He's always looking at this life ending and being out of his body in light of the life that is to come. There's a big difference. One can be depression clothed up in some form of Christianity. The other one is godly. We in this we groan. Not that we would be unclothed. That I just want to get out of this body and it be over and done. You might have said that yourself. You might have heard someone say that. And then there's nothing that comes after it. But that would be clothed upon. You want that. That's your hope. And so he's bringing it up in context of the new body. And look what he's going to, I haven't even got to it yet. Look at verse 5. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the what? Earnest of the Spirit. The earnest of the Spirit given to us is the reason why we can groan. It's the basis upon, verse 5 is the basis upon verses 1 through 4. And the groaning that we can have in connection with it. Look at, I'm just going to kind of go in order here. Look at Galatians chapter 5. Come with me to Galatians chapter 5. So again, the reason why we're doing what we're doing is to show you that this information sets the foundation for other things that Paul's going to say. And as we get to those sections, we're going to refer back to what we learned here in Romans chapter 8 and see then there the particular context that he's bringing it up in. But look at Galatians chapter 5. Pick it up here in verse 22. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. The second, third, and fourth play a part in what we're learning in Romans chapter 8. Joy, peace, long-suffering. In other words, the first fruits of the Spirit in connection with our hope, in connection with the glory, in connection with our inheritance, some of the things that it's supposed to produce. What's another similar word to long-suffering? Patience. We do with patience wait for it. You're waiting. You're long-suffering. Remember we dealt with that when we were dealing with suffering with him? And we went back to Romans chapter 2. You not know that the goodness, forbearance, and long-suffering of God leadeth thee to repentance? That God is long-suffering today. He's long-suffering. And one of the similar things to that is patience. That's what we're learning in Romans chapter 8. One of the main things that's going to come out of Romans chapter 8 is you to have a godly patience in suffering. But also it can come from it is because you have a hope is peace, but also joy. I want you to see those all connected. It may not make as much sense right now, but if you look at Romans 15, Paul's going to do something when we're getting close to getting out of Romans. Look at Romans 15, look at verse 13. Here's another verse in Romans itself that finds its foundation in the previous chapters, and it's going to actually build upon it. He says in verse 13, now the God of what? See, we've been learning hope. We've been learning hope in Romans 5. We've been learning hope in Romans 8. We're not done. We're going to learn more about hope in Romans 12. And now we get to Romans 15. In verse 13, he says, now the God of hope. He authored it. The hope proceeds from him to the point that we can give him that moniker. He's the God of hope. And look what he does. through the doctrine. Now the God of hope fill you with all what? Who's going to fill you with all joy? Not just God, but the God of what? Hope, meaning his hope can give you joy. Fill you with all joy. And we're in both contexts that we've looked at this morning, Romans 5 and Romans 8, are in the context of what? Suffering. Tribulation. You're in a state and condition when you're in tribulation, suffering, is to be filled with hope. Because that's the state and condition where you're less likely to have hope. But he's the God of hope. Fill you with all joy and what? Peace. But don't miss those next two words. In what?
Believing.
In believing. You gotta believe it. And what's going to aid your believing is minding it and reckoning it and thinking about it, getting in it, thinking about the details, gaining his perspective, that ye may abound in hope through the power of the who? Yeah, because he's the one that had his shedding abroad the love of God ministry in Romans 5, the sealing. Yeah, the Romans 8, the leading of the Spirit in the earnest of the Spirit, the first fruits of the Spirit. It's going to be through him. Through that doctrine and you believing it. It's that dichotomy of the Spirit leading and you walking after, just like Romans 8 is teaching us, in you believing that you're going to be filled. And not only that, but that you may abound in it. And that abounding ministry we'll see eventually in Ephesians. And it's even more magnified with the Thessalonians. And so the fruit of the Spirit here in Galatians chapter 5, attached to the hope, is joy, peace, long-suffering. It's not the only thing they're attached to, but some of the things. So Paul will later refer to some of these things that come out of Romans 8 as the fruit of the Spirit, like in Galatians chapter 5. Let's just look at one more and then I'll end. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Since we're in Galatians 5, just maybe turn a page. Maybe it's on the same pages. Look at Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1 is going to be that point where you learn about all wisdom. And how to abound. And I want you to see something here. We'll pick it up here in verse 11. He says, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, that's in Christ, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things out after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ. In whom ye also, what? Trusted. Did these saints at Ephesus trust in Christ? Yeah. What's that next word? After that, ye heard the word of truth. After they had trusted, they have heard the word. They heard the word of truth. Paul uses this expression many, many times. In fact, one we quote a lot. It's the top verse up on the timeline. 2 Timothy 2, verse 15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing what? Did you ever read the saying and the verses before verse 15? Guess what it's in connection with? Suffering and glory. And that glory of reigning with him. The word of truth is the word of truth of why you're saved. Why you're justified. Why am I justified? The word of truth is going to tell you. You know there's two words of truth, as it were. That's why you got to rightly divide them. Because Israel is justified for a different calling, a different purpose. And we, today, are saved and justified for a different calling, a different purpose. Both have glory involved with it, both have reigning involved, but we got to rightly divide that. And after we have trusted, after that, he's talking to these saints at Ephesus, in whom you also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth. And what is the word of truth? The gospel of your salvation. And whom also after that ye believed, hearkening back to the issue of in whom ye also trusted, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise, which we learned about in Romans 5, verse 14, which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. Now, that's not telling you anything different than what we've been going through in Romans chapter 8. This is telling you that the order of some things. But my understanding there when he says the gospel of your salvation is he's not, there's a reason why he says your salvation. He doesn't say the gospel of salvation. And he's not, and he's saying the gospel of your salvation and why he's going to pray for them that you might know the hope of his calling and these kind of things and why eventually in Ephesians chapter 2 he's going to give that passage where we're able to rightly divide and those kind of things and why in Ephesians 3 he's going to talk about our ministry and connection with the heavenly places and why in Ephesians 4 he's going to talk about our walking worthy of our vocation. It's your salvation, and the salvation is in connection with our hope, in connection with the heavenly places, at which he's going to talk about as you get to the end of chapter 1. When we've hit Romans chapter 8, we've hit the good news of our salvation. Not just the issue of the good news of being justified from the debt and penalty of our sins. That is good news. Please don't get me wrong. But after that ye had trusted, we heard the word of truth, the gospel, the good news of our salvation in connection with our hope. The hope of his calling in connection with the creature. And it's tied to the redemption of the purchased possession. That's our inheritance. That's our new redeemed bodies. I gotta stop, but we're going to pick up next week, and we'll see that this also has ramifications for something else he says here in Ephesians, as well as in 1 Thessalonians. He calls a piece of the armor that we're supposed to be put on, the helmet of salvation. It is not the salvation of our debt and penalty of our sins. The helmet of our salvation is the mind that's supposed to be stayed on. The hope that's supposed to be stayed on our minds. Part of it, yes, is about justification, but it's part of that sealing, but it's also the earnest expectation of the Spirit. It's to be a helmet for us. In Philippians chapter 1, he's going to talk about it as a supply of the Spirit of Christ Jesus. So it becomes a lot of things for us and to us in Christ that I just want to highlight so that we don't minimize what we are being given here in Romans chapter 8, but rather that we glorify what we've been given here in Romans chapter 8 and all the things that it's going to be to us. We'll pick that up next week, and next session we'll be in 1 Timothy chapter 3 and in verse 16. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this time to look into your word, to look into Romans chapter 8 there, and the very first things that the Spirit leads us in, Father, according to the doctrinal order of Paul's epistles. The very first things that we are to understand, as we've learned that not only we've been given the Spirit, we've been sealed, but that he leads us, and we are to walk after him. The very first thing is the issue of our inheritance. About glory and how those things are connected directly to the creature and how we will participate in delivering the creature from the bondage of corruption and function as the new creature, the body of Christ. And Father, how will take place in a new body, the redemption of our bodies that we wait for. And Father, we thank you for all the fruit that comes from that leading ministry of the Spirit in connection with our inheritance and our glory, as it is our hope. It provides us long-suffering, it provides us patience, it also provides us joy, at least it ought to, in the midst of the sufferings, peace and joy, long-suffering, patience. How when it is under attack by the things that we experience, that it becomes our armor, it becomes the helmet of our salvation. That it is our hope, and that it is the good news of our salvation. Not only being saved from the debt and penalty of our sins, Father, but as we experience sufferings, whether it be sufferings from this present time or sufferings that come from living godly in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, that there is a salvation, a deliverance that awaits us, that causes us to wait patiently for it, because the glory is incomparable to what we could go through on this earth. So may it do all that for us. And may, like Paul says, even though we don't have the complete doctrinal understanding, at least at the point we're at in Romans 8, but may it be, as Paul says there in Romans 15, verse 13, now the God of hope fill us with all joy and peace in believing, that we might abound in hope. Father, may we be a people, as your sons and daughters, knowing this doctrine, be those that in the most dire situations and circumstances, as well as in the norm of life, be those who manifest the abundance of hope that we have in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, as we've learned them, as the Spirit has taught them to us in your word. That we might glorify you for the things that you have yet to come, that we get to benefit now as first fruits. We give you all the thanks and praise in your Son's name. And we, as always, end by praying, if there's anyone here listening, if they have not trusted Christ, how that he died for their sins, was buried, and rose again, may they believe that. And the moment they do, they'll be justified unto eternal life in God's sight. All their sins forgiven, past, present, future, your righteousness imputed unto them, and they'll possess the gift of eternal life. May they not let another moment pass, but believe this very moment. And we thank you for this time of grace giving, that we give in light of your mind, not grudgingly, not out of necessity, for you love a cheerful giver. You are the most cheerful, the greatest giver of all, as manifested in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Christ himself, who, although he was rich, he became poor, that we might become rich in him. And Father, how that graciousness ought to be manifested in our giving. Not just for any reason, but with the intelligent understanding that that gracious giving goes to graciously provide the truth from the pulpit here at Twin Cities Grace Fellowship to maintain and sustain this assembly. And what a privilege that is. So, Father, we give you all the thanks and praise in Christ's name. Amen.